So hello, I'm Jonathan Peters from the Ultra Microscopy Group in Trinity College Dublin, and I'm going to be going through how we are improving the frameworks we can get from our stems. So first of all, like, why do we want to improve our frame rate? So you know, in the stem we've got this you know, concentrated beam of electrons going into samples, scanning it across. So that's quite bad for beam damage. You know, the serial nature of this is relatively slow, so we can't capture dynamic events doing in-situ experiments. And also we get quite a lot of like distortions, like from drift and vibrations appearing in our image. So by, you know, reducing the frame rate, basically improve all of that, just make things much more flexible and easy for us. So to actually go through how we're going to reduce the frame time, we need to work out what goes into it. So we've got this equation, and we've got the useful time here, which is actually the image, and it's basically the number of pixels and how long we spend each pixel. Then we have a flyback time, so at the end of each scan line, we go back to the start, and because we've got hysteresis in the magnetic lenses, we have to wait a bit. And then we have this, what we call frame flyback time. That's a bit more mysterious, kind of depends on the hardware, and there's like data stream and stuff like that. So before we've addressed the flyback issue in this paper we've got here, we think this frame flyback time is out of our control, something we might need to buy new hardware for. So then we're left with this. The dwell time is limited by hardware again, so we've reduced the number of pixels. So there are some approaches doing this where you do something like a spiral scan, but that requires new hardware. It's got its own problems with where the beam position it actually is. And it can't be used with like the traditional the techniques that we've been using. So we do interlacing, so we maintain this linear scan. And obviously it's an old technique that we've used in televisions for about 100 years, I guess, since television was invented. Basically, we're just skipping every other line. And this is used for exactly the same reason we want to use it, just for a set bandwidth, you can get higher resolution or more frame rate. So then the question is, can we apply this to STEM and looking more towards a sort of atomic resolution end of things? In particular, we don't want to be buying new hardware, so we're using things like a DigiScan 2, which is quite common. So then, first thing we're going to do is say it's been about 100 years, so there's various ways of deinterlacing an image to an interlaced image. So first thing we're going to do is compare them for STEM. So we've got this is an experimental image up here, but a full frame image. And then what we're doing is we're interlacing it and then deinterlacing it. And then we can compare to this ground truth. So we've just got a couple of examples here, and you know, we want this to be basically close to zero, so that'd be white. In these images. So on this graph here, I've got a few techniques. We want to be on this y-axis, you know, down the bottom. That's the least difference. We also want to consider the time. So as we go faster and faster, the reconstruction technique wants to go faster and faster, so we can do this live. So I'm not going to go through all of them, but I'm just going to group them generally. So this is our line doubling up here. It's just here, it's just repeating every line. It's very quick, it's not very good. We tried some more advanced in-painting algorithms, and they're a bit better. They're quite slow, but they're not, as you can see, the best. So the best here, we've actually got a bicubic interpolation. And that's just better than this sort of somewhat arbitrary, but kind of nice target of 30 frames a second we eventually want to get to. But what we find actually is this bilinear one down here is, in most cases, pretty good and quite fast. So you, you know, you can choose depending on the image, but this is sort of like a good starting point. But I do want to highlight that obviously we're doing this all this interpolation, we're not actually, you know, getting new data, we're just inferring between. So you get problems if you go too low resolution, it's near the Likert frequency, we don't reconstruct the image properly, so this, you know, should look like this. And also based on the noise, if you've got a noisy image, you know, by doing this deinterlacing, we're again not getting more information, so we're still limited. And you know, we might, for example, pick up positions of atoms differently or incorrectly. So moving on to the actual frame rates, we've got some videos here which are taken of these gold nanoparticles. This is on our neon with the DigiScan. And as you can see, the maybe not as fast as we want. So this is slightly disappointing. But based on these imaging conditions I've got here, so this top one's basically the interlaced one and we get the full frame version here. Whereas you might expect these conditions like 5 frames a second interlaced, it's more like 2. We also have this problem with full frames, we might expect 2.5 here, we get 1.5. And this is all down to this final frame flyback time here, which is 0.27 seconds. So in this top case here, that's more than half the imaging time is lost to whatever's happening here. But anyway, we're still getting a 40% improvement for, essentially for free. So that's nice, that's good improvement still. But to go further, again, it might be new hardware. So another thing we've been doing is quite popular. Is so again in the scanning thing, it's a bit sad but inevitable that we're going to get distortions in our images. So one way to do this is multi-frame imaging, and then we can use that stack of images to diagnose and correct any drift, vibrations, etc. It works a lot better. Ideally, we want some like rotation between the images. It helps us diagnose the distortions. But what was found is a 2017 paper. Is for strain precision, it works quite well. Any of this ferroelectric materials, when we do a lot of strain engineering, semiconductors, catalysis, stuff like that. So for a fixed dose, so here you've got 4 frames at 10 microseconds dwell time, or 40 frames at 1 second dwell time. If we increase the number of frames, we get a lower error in the strain. And this should go as 1 over root of n. The number of frames. I highlight here that the trends, this is the experimental data, it should follow this green line down here, but it doesn't quite meet it, there's some discrepancy. I'll discuss that just in a second. And I'm just showing here the qualitatively, we do interlacing versus full frame, we're doing sampling. It all looks pretty good, it's pretty similar, you can't really tell the difference. Okay, so then what we're saying, what we're going to do now is for this N sort of set dose budget, can we improve that, improve the strain precision using interlacing? So to do that, to give it a sort of like a good comparison, fair comparison, what we've done is we've taken our simulations. So this is a STO simulation which had 0 strain in it, and then we're adding in these sort of noise and drift. And we're just using a load of sine waves, and they have varying frequency, amplitude, phase, the direction they kind of travel across the image. And we can then corrupt the image to include these. And then we can apply the exact same distortion field in time to the interlaced images and compare how the reconstruction is. So just to show what the actual strain looks like, add a bit of colour to the presentation. If you go from 1 frame to 40 frames, we get a lot of strain variation here. Again, it should be 0. 8 frames, better, 40 frames, so it's pretty good. And the way we're going to quantify this is with the standard deviation of the strain. So plotting that all on one graph, so on the left one here, this is the simulated data. So we've got full frame where we've got the rotation between the frames. Interlace and then interlace with the rotation again. And you can see this blue line here is the full frame data, and then as we go down, we get better strain precision. We see the interlace and full frame with rotation are pretty similar here in the middle. And then the best one is the interlace with rotation. So that's all the way down here. And based on the this 1/3 proportionality, we expect to have a root 2, so 1.4 basically, difference, or improvement between them. And if you measure this out, so if you do simulation without the rotation, that's looking pretty good. With the rotation, we're a bit short of that, so there might be some improvements to be made there. And then I've got the confirm this experimentally. You know, so we can't do the rotation to, I should say, a digiscan doesn't officially support this, but you can make it do it quite easily. And so we've got this, the same discrepancy at higher frame numbers, but in all cases we've got an improvement using the interlacing, and again it's around 1.4, which is nice. So just to sort of finish off, what we actually did is we've got the simulations, and we can add in noise, kind of again emulate the experimental data. If we add in Gaussian noise in particular, we can see we've got the same. You know, we don't get quite the same split precision that we want at these higher frame numbers. So what we're doing, so I don't know if anyone saw Tina's post yesterday, but he's got a technique which we're using to eliminate this Gaussian noise, so we'll just have Poisson noise, and that should be fine. So hopefully this figure will be actually down here on the left experimentally. So just to wrap up, you know, so we've seen that using interlacing we can get these higher frame rates. Is maybe not as good as it is, it should be, but 40% is still pretty good, and we've not had to spend any money. Yeah, so is this brain of light time is really what's limiting us now, and I guess we can look into that a bit more, and a few things you might be able to do, but ultimately it might be down to the hardware. And then we're putting this all together, so we're going to these faster frame rates, we're going to this electron counting, so we can eliminate the actual noise, so we should be able to get faster frame rates. Yeah, excellent straight precision. And then we'll go from there. So finally, just thank these lovely people who sat over there. James is also a lovely person who helped us just verify some of the experimental measurements that we made. It's these lovely people for funding, and you lovely people for listening.